Okay, my dear students, we are going to start now. Please have a sheet of paper and a pen with you. So at the end, I think we need to solve one simple problem on gradient matrix, gradient vector, and Hessian matrix. Okay, so please have a sheet of paper and simple problem. Okay, so please try to have one sheet of paper and a pen with you. Okay, so we are going to start today. The second part of the module 2, which is optimization concepts. See, in this optimization concepts, see, once you complete this chapter, you will be able to define a local and global minima for unconstrained and constrained optimization problems, and you can write optimality conditions for unconstrained problems and also for constrained problems. And you will be able to check optimality of a given point for unconstrained and constrained problems. And next one is you will be able to solve first order optimality conditions for candidate minimum points, and you can check convexity of a function and the design optimization problems. And at the end, you will be able to use the Lagrange multipliers to study the changes to the optimum value of the first function due to variations in the. See, these are the things what you will be able to do at the end of this chapter. In the sense, the most important thing is you will be able to define local and global minima. So these are two important things. So you will be able to discuss what is this local and global minima for both the unconstrained and constrained optimization problems. And you will be able to derive, or you will be able to obtain the optimality conditions for both constrained and unconstrained problems. And you will be able to check the optimality conditions for given point for both constrained and unconstrained problems. And you can check the convexity of a function, design optimization problems. And at the end, you can use a Lagrange multipliers. Study the changes to the optimum value of the cost function due to the variation in the constraint. So these are the things what you will going to be able to do at the end of this chapter. See, before I just take you for the actual concepts of local and global minima, so I need to refresh some of the calculus part of your mathematics. Okay. So I don't know whether you have studied these things in your mathematics, whether it's PG or UG, but once you understand the different basic concepts of calculus, generally I can for discussing regarding the different local and global, and to get the necessary and sufficient information. Okay, so in today's class, I will be just concentrating on four important functions, okay, so which are very important for us to understand to derive the necessary and sufficient conditions for the optimization. Okay, so in the next week onwards, in the next class onwards, I'll be starting with the actual local and global minimum concept. Okay, so what we are starting now, it is the second part of the module 2. The first part we have finished already for formulation of optimization problems. Now this will be the second question in the module 2 you want to get it, so which is based upon these optimality conditions, okay, the optimization concept what we generally call it. Okay, so once we discuss, I think today we can discuss two important functions, their mathematical forms, and at the end of this class, so you might be having one simple problem to solve. So please have a sheet of paper and a pen with you. Very simple problem, not a difficult thing. So you can solve within 5-10 minutes. You can solve the problem and you can get the solution for that. Okay. So today we are going to start with that. Yeah. See, the review of some basic calculus concepts. So this is very important. So once you understand these things, because once you know what are these things, then only we can easily understand the concepts of optimality. Okay. In this section, we review basic concepts from calculus using a vector and matrix notation. So these things you might have studied in your mathematics, but still it's my duty to review these things because these are very important things for us, because once we don't understand what are these words, what are these terms basically, and if you could not able to apply these terms in a proper way, it's very difficult for us to understand and to apply the necessary conditions and also sufficient conditions for optimality. So therefore, today we will start with the review of some basic calculus concepts. So there are four different matrix things with vector and matrix notations that we need to discuss. One is called gradient vector. The gradient vector for a function of several variables requiring first partial derivative of the function is defined. So first we are going to define what is a gradient vector, okay, and what is its mathematical form, how we can write the mathematical form of a gradient vector. Second thing is Hessian matrix. Hessian matrix for the function requiring the second partial derivative of the function. And the third one is the Taylor's expansions for functions of single and multiple variables. And the fourth is the concept of quadratic form, which is needed to discuss sufficiency conditions for optimality. So why I'm talking all these four vector and matrix notations here is, these are the basic mathematics required for us to arrive at as necessary and sufficient conditions for optimality. In the sense, what we generally call it as optimality conditions. So optimality conditions means there are two. One is the function has to satisfy the necessary condition, and the function has to satisfy the sufficient condition. So to obtain these, or to arrive at these two conditions, or to satisfy these two conditions, so we need to have a little bit of knowledge of basic calculus. So without it, because all these things will be involved and it will be used in arriving at the necessary and sufficient conditions for a single variable as well as for multivariables, for both constrained as well as unconstrained problems. So therefore, so let us just quickly review means, of course, quickly means we'll go to review these things in a little bit time, because this is very important. I think this is the most important thing for you people. So let us just discuss these things on one or two classes, and later part I will just take you for the actual concepts of optimality. Okay, so please remember, these are the four important vector and matrix notations that needs to be remembered and needs to be used. One is a gradient vector, a first partial derivative of the function is defined, Hessian matrix, the second partial derivative of the function, Taylor expansion, functions of single and multiple variables, and the concept of quadratic form, which is very much required for us to discuss the sufficiency conditions for optimality. Okay, let us start with the first one, the gradient vector. Yeah, look at here, a gradient vector, it is a partial derivative of a function. Consider a function f of x of n variables, x1, comma x2 to xn. The partial derivative of the function with respect to x1 at a given point x star is defined as, okay, so you can see that is del of x x star divided by del of x1 with respect to x2, like this. This is the differential form what you are writing over here. Okay, so a vector, when you say a function, which is a function of, which is a f of x is a variable, sorry, a function f of x of variables n1, x1, x2, xn, then the partial derivative of that respective function with respect to the x1 at a given point x star will be written in their differential forms. So you should be in a position to know how to write these differential forms. Okay, so with respect to x2 and with respect to x1 and since with respect to xn, so how we can represent. If c suffix I represents the partial derivative of f of x with respect to xi at that point x star, then we can represent all partial derivative of f of x as follows. So this is the the generalized differential partial differential equations they are given here. Ti corresponds to the partial derivative of f of x with respect to xi at point x star. Okay, so therefore the partial derivative of x, all partial derivatives of f of x will be written as f delta f of x divided by xi, where I is equal to 1 to n. This is how they will go to write. For convenience and compactness of notation, we arrange the partial derivatives into a column vector called the gradient vector and represent it by any of the following symbols. See, when we say ci, it represents the partial derivative of the function f at a point x star. So for the convenience and compactness of the notation, all these partial derivatives will be arranged and it will be written in the form of a column vector. So that column vector, we call it as a gradient vector. Okay, and it is represented by any of the following symbol. So gradient vector is represented as c, or del of x del f of x by x dot delta x, or gradient f, grad f, anything you can call it as. All these things corresponds to the gradient vector. Okay, so what we have shown here is c, a gradient vector at a point x star, can be written as, please remember this, please make a note of this, this is very important. So if you have a paper and a pen, please make a note of this equation. The gradient vector is represented either by c or del of f of x star, which is equal to, please make a note of this equation, this is very important for us. So once we want to solve the problem at the end, so we need to get we need to use this equation. Okay, where subscript t denotes transpose of a vector or a matrix. Note that all the partial derivatives are calculated at the given point x star. That is, each component of the gradient vector is a function in itself, which must be evaluated at the given point x star. So usually we are shown it as a transpose vector, transpose of a vector. So basically it is a column vector, it is a column vector. So I have just written the form of a transpose vector, transpose of that. So the partial derivatives are always calculated at the given point x star. That is, each component of the gradient vector is a function in itself, which must be evaluated at the given point x. So this is very important to note, because when you are calculating these things, you should write down these things very carefully. Okay, so next comes the Hessian matrix, or second partial derivatives. The first one, what we discussed, it is a gradient vector, which is a first or a partial derivative of a first partial derivative. And here the Hessian matrix is a second order partial derivative. So this Hessian matrix is obtained from the differentiating a gradient vector once again. We obtain a matrix of partial derivatives for all the for a function f of x called the Hessian matrix, or simply Hessian. That is, differentiating each component of the gradient vector above with respect to x1, x2, till xn, we obtain. See, in the previous slide, what I have shown, this is a gradient vector. This is a first partial derivative, first order partial derivative. And when you differentiate again the gradient vector with respect to x1, x2, and x3, or to xn, then you will be obtaining the second order partial derivative of a function f of x, and which we call it as Hessian matrix, or simply the Hessian. Okay, so this is the representation of a Hessian matrix. See, when you say f of x, dou of f, or dou of f of x at x star, at x, with respect to x, so we are getting, this is the expression what we are getting with respect to the Hessian matrix. Please make a note of this Hessian matrix also. This is very important for you, because you should be in a position to write down the Hessian matrix and the gradient vector. Until unless you know how to get a gradient vector and a Hessian matrix, we cannot further proceed in the optimality condition. So that's the reason why I am taking these concepts in the beginning itself. So once you understand all these concepts, then things will be easy for everybody to do. Okay. So Hessian matrix, the gradient vector. Once again, we obtain a matrix of second order derivative. So please make a note of this Hessian matrix. Please make a note of, everybody should make note of this Hessian matrix. So it is also a matrix notation. So look at that subscripts 1, 2, 3 and all those things. This is very important for you to note it down. I hope you might have completed just noting down this Hessian matrix. Okay, I will just move to the next slide. So in this Hessian matrix, where all derivatives are calculated at the given point x star, the Hessian matrix is a n cross n matrix. It is a n cross n matrix, also denoted as H or del square F. It is important to note that each element of the Hessian is a function in itself that is evaluated at the given point x star. Also, since f of x is assumed to be at twice continuously differentiable, the cross partial derivatives are also equal. So please remember here the cross partial derivatives. So what we are talking about cross partial derivatives. So here we have shown the mathematical form of the cross partial derivatives are equal. So del square f of dou xy, dou of xj, it should be equal to dou square f of dou of xj into dou of xi. So look at this denominator term. So first we have xi, and with respect to xj, second one, the first partial derivative in the second case is with respect to j, and the second partial derivative with respect to I, where I is equal to 1 to n and j is equal to 1 to n. So this is what we call it as the cross partial derivatives are equal. This is also, you should be very careful while you are just noting down, because these things are very useful for us when you are solving the problem, and also when we are attaining at what you call it as the optimality condition. Okay, so Hessian matrix, basically it is a n cross n. So rows and columns will be always equal. So it is a symmetric matrix. Okay, so please remember this, and it is evaluated at a given point x star. Okay, and also since f of x is assumed to be twice continuously differentiable, the cross partial derivatives are equal. So these things you should be very very careful. Very you should remember these things so that we can solve one problem at the. Okay, therefore the Hessian is always symmetric matrix. Please make a note of this. Hessian is a symmetric matrix. It plays a prominent role in the sufficiency conditions for optimality, as discussed later in this chapter. It will be written as, so please look at this, the Hessian matrix, we generally denote it as a H or dou square F. Okay, so dou square f divided by dou of xj with and dou of xi, where I is equal to 1 to n and j is equal to 1 to n. So this is a very important thing what you're supposed to note it down. Okay, so this is the two important basics of calculus I wanted to discuss in today's class. Okay, So I have one problem after this. Okay, so how to calculate the gradient vector and the Hessian matrix. Okay, so before I go, I will just go back to the gradient vector. So please, if you have not noted down, please make a note of this gradient vector. Okay, so how we can write the gradient vector? So it is a column vector. It is a column vector. You can write dou of f of x. So like that, if you want, I will just show it with a new share. If you want, I will show it with a whiteboard. So you can write t is equal to. Okay. So it is a gradient vector. X star. I think I am finding it difficult to write it on a whiteboard. So please make a note of this. So this is just a column vector. So you can write it in the column wise. Okay, and you can just write down. And this is the gradient vector. And this is the Hessian matrix. Hessian matrix. So please make a note of these two things. It's very important. So this is the gradient vector. And this is the Hessian matrix. Okay. So now I will give you one problem. So this is the problem. This problem is asked once in your exam for 8 marks. Please please unmute yourself, everybody. Please unmute.
But we can't see the problem.
You can't see?
Problem.
No, sir. Yeah. Problem.
It's not visible.
No, sir.
No, sir. No, no, sir. It's not visible.
Still, we are seeing whiteboard.
Oh, wait. Just a minute. Just a minute. Now?
No, sir.
Now can you see?
Yes, sir, we can see.
Yeah, please make a note of this problem now. F of x is equal to x1 cube plus x2 cube. If for the following function, calculate the gradient vector and Hessian matrix at the point 1 comma 2. Are you able to get this problem? Okay. So what you want to do is, you want to calculate the function is this one. Okay. So the function is a variable of x1 and x2. Okay. So we have to calculate this gradient vector and Hessian matrix with respect to a point 1 comma 2, where 1 is x1 and x2 is 2. Let's make a note of that. X1 is 1, x2 is 2. Okay, so now let us move on to the gradient vector. So what is gradient vector here? So C is equal to first partial derivative of x1 with respect to x1. So like this, you have to get a gradient vector. Okay, so you have only two variables, so only we're going to get the two terms only, because n is equal to 2 here, so we're going to get the first two terms over here. So what you're supposed to do is, you have to differentiate this f of x with respect to x1 first, with respect to x1, and the second one, differentiate this with respect to x2. Are you following what I'm talking?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So first you differentiate f of x with respect to x1. With respect to x1. Yeah. Then same function, you differentiate that with respect to x2. With respect to x2. Okay, so what will be the differentiation equation, sorry, function of differentiation with respect to x1? Anybody can tell? With respect to x1, when you differentiate with respect to x1, what you are getting?
3x1 square.
3?
Plus x1 square.
3x1 square.
Plus 4. Plus.
Hello.
3x1 square plus 4x1 minus x2 plus 2.
Very good. Yes. It is a 3x1 square plus 4x1 minus x2 plus 2. So that is with respect to x1. Next, with respect to x2.
3x2 square
3x2
plus 6x2,
6x2
minus x1 plus 4.
Minus x1 plus 4. Okay, so now what you have to do is, you use the two points 1 comma 2. So in both the expressions for differential form x1 and x2, put x1 as 1 and x2 as 2. And substitute and get me what is the first derivative with respect to x1 and second first derivative with respect to x2. Substitute the values
7
of
and 27.
7 and?
27.
7 and 27. Right. So now you go back to the form of a gradient vector. C is equal to, this is the form actually you're supposed to get. So actually it is a gradient vector. It is a column vector. I have shown it is a transpose vector. So no problem. So we are going to get, it is a 7 is the first and second, 27 is the second. So I think you can see the value over here. The answer is C is equal to 7 comma 27. Are you able to get it?
Yes, sir.
So this is how you are going to get a gradient vector. Then the second one is we want to get the Hessian matrix. Hessian matrix. So what we supposed to do? So when you look at the Hessian matrix over here, so again we have only two variables, x1 and x2. So therefore the size of the rank of a matrix will be 2 cross 2 over here. So where the Hessian matrix will always be in an order of n cross n, where n is the number of variables. Okay, so since the number of variables in this problem is only 2, x1 and x2, so therefore the size, the rank of a matrix will be only 2 cross 2. Here it is. Okay, so now what we want to do here is we want to get a Hessian matrix. So once you want to get a Hessian matrix, so the same thing what you have used for a gradient vector, same thing you can use it here. The first derivative with respect to x1 is there, no? You again differentiate that with respect to x1 on second. Del of f of x divided by a cos x1. You differentiate that. Second derivative, you get it. Please remember, you have to get these values. These four. See, all these four terms, you have to get it now. All these four terms, please remember. So all these four terms will constitute the Hessian matrix for this problem. Okay, so please get the terms of each one by just differentiating with respect to x1 or with respect to x2. So please get this and get me the equations first. You tell me the equations first, and later we will going to discuss how we will going to get it. So second derivative with respect to x1, anybody could able to do
6x1 plus 4.
Sorry?
6x1 plus 4.
6x plus 4. Right. So that is a second derivative with respect to x1. Okay. Again, the same thing. The first derivative you differentiate with respect to x2 further. See this one. We want this one. See this term now. The second term, what I am showing in the cursor, mouse cursor. So first derivative dou of f with respect to x1 you have done. Same thing you differentiate with respect to x2 now. What you will going to get, you tell.
Minus 1.
Minus 1, yes. So only because in that term you will going to get only minus x2 will be there. So minus x2 differentiated with respect to x2, you will going to get minus 1. Right, that is the one thing. Next, second derivative. So that is dou square with respect to x2. So differentiate with respect to x once again and differentiate the same equation with respect to x1 later. So two equations you are supposed to get. Now I want with respect to x2 first. You had 3x2 square plus 6x2 plus minus x1 plus 4. You differentiate that with respect to x2.
Six x2 plus six.
6x2 plus 6, sir.
Yes.
Okay, 6x2 plus 6. Yeah. Now apply that term, that values of 1 and 2 and get me what is the total value for that second partial derivative with respect to x2.
10 and 18.
80, yes. So you are getting 80. And similarly, the same first derivative with respect to x2, you differentiate with respect to x1, the cross partial derivatives. Cross partial derivatives. Would you be able to get minus 1?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now arrange all those things in this form. In this form. So here, only this first four terms you will be able to get it. So dou square f of dou x1 square. So you have got 10 for 10 here. Dou square f by dou x1 with dou x2, it is minus 1. Dou square f by dou x2 with respect to dou x1, it is minus 1 again. Dou square f by dou x2 square, it is 18. So you can see the matrix which is in the form of n minus 1 minus 1, 18. So it is just like a symmetric matrix of order n cross n. You can see the n cross n where n is equal to 2. So 2 cross 2 matrix over here. So this is very important. Why? Because once you understand how to get a gradient vector and Hessian matrix, then only you can further proceed for obtaining the optimality condition. Because we want everything, all these terms and the calculations will be involved, or it has been included in attaining the optimality conditions, both necessary as well as sufficient conditions. Okay, so therefore I have just taken this as refresher class for you, even though whether you have studied these things in your lower classes, but it's my duty, because just directly if I take you for the conditions, optimality conditions, so you will be struggling, you will definitely be going to struggle. So I don't want that. So let us make things much more clear. So let us take one or two classes, we will spend, not an issue for us. So where you people have to understand the basics of calculus, some, not everything, some of the things which is required for me to take you for the further concepts, optimization concept. That's why I have taken this. Of course, there are so many problems are there, but everything remains same. Only thing, please remember how to get a gradient vector and how to form the Hessian matrix. So if you remember those two things, then rest of things, next class I will be talking about Taylor series and also quadratic forms. So these two other important things which is very much required for me, so that once you understand all these things, how the Taylor series will be, Taylor expansion will be done, so, and how quadratic forms will be represented. Once you understand this, rest of things will be very simple. Okay, so any clarification, any doubts, you can talk to me. Only just 30 seconds is the quote for me. Otherwise, I will just get on. Anything to ask?
Our notes is not there in the classroom, sir.
Which one?
Notes. Google Classroom.
PPT I just loaded, no?
No, sir.
It is nothing there in.
PPT I noted.
We can't.
Okay, okay.
We can't find, sir.